How can I call on your name and end up in shame? No way, no way. How can I sing a song before you and then bow down before a man? No way, no way. Because you are my God. You are my God. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd rather be a failure with God than to succeed without Him. And when I say God, I'm talking about Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Because God in our world today means anything. There are people God means themselves. There are others God means their bank accounts. There are others God means their several qualifications, as important as that is. My Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Proverbs 3 and verse 5. It says, lean not unto your own understanding. Verse 6 says, in all your ways, acknowledge him and he shall direct your path. Verse 7 says, be not wise in your own understanding. It says, fear the Lord and depart. Turn away from evil. Except the Lord builds a house, my Bible says, they labor in vain that will build it. Except the Lord watches over a city, said the watchman, watch it, but in vain. That it is vain to wake up in the morning and to sleep late at night, only to eat the bread of sorrow. The psalmist said, how many are they that rise up against me, Psalm 3. Many are they that say, where is your help? But he says, thou, O Lord, thou, O Lord, thou, O Lord, you are a shield for me. He calls him my glory and the lifter up of my head. The Bible says they looked up to him and their faces were lightened. You cannot look up to him and be in shame. When the serpents came to oppress the nation of Israel, they had an opportunity to look two directions. The brazen serpent representing the cross, or the one that was coming to them. Ladies and gentlemen, behind the exploits and the rest of men that we admire in our world today, men and women in ministry, champions in the kingdom, in business, in family, behind all the excellence, the admirable results, is a passion for God. I've had the honor and the opportunity to meet people whose lives are an epitome of excellence. Behind all of that paraphernalia, when you come to them, you find out that their real secret is not the intellect. Their real secret is not the banking skill. Their real secret is their love and their passion for Jesus. Hallelujah. In addition to having an encounter with Jesus, you want to become spiritually minded? Your prayer altar must be on fire. We are still discussing point one. This is what it takes to be spiritually minded. Number one, to have an encounter with the Son of the living God. Number two, your prayer life. It is the apostolic model that was left with the church. You want to be spiritual, it is not without a healthy prayer life. Acts chapter 2 and verse 42. The Bible says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, and in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayer. Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, it says, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. Luke chapter 18 and verse 1, he spake a parable to the end that men ought always to pray and not to faint. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 17, it says, pray without ceasing. James chapter 5 and verse 13, is any man afflicted, he says, let him pray. Mark 11 and verse 24, it says, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that thou receivest them, and thou shalt have it. Ladies and gentlemen, the men who will command exploits in their world and find rest, tame life like an animal, are men and women who understand the mysteries of the altar. We must obtain grace to pray. We must obtain grace to pray. Prayer is not for men of God. is not for pastors and apostles and evangelists. Please listen to me. Dear parents and the aged, Anna the prophetess was old. She still prayed. Young men, Jesus prayed. You must pray. We must revive prayer as a culture with understanding. A generation that does not pray will be a weak generation that will never see the power of God. I tell you sincerely. And I'm not just talking of need-driven prayer. Give me, give me, give me. I'm talking of men who build capacity within the spirit. Peter, Satan had desired to sift you like wheat. He says, but I have prayed for you that your faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen your brethren. Show me a man of God who prays. I show you a victor, one who will have rest on every side. Show me a businessman who prays. Show me a mother who prays. No matter how stubborn that child is, let the mother keep praying. One day fire from heaven will locate that child no matter where he is. I tell you, most people do not know the power in prayer. Go and read church history and see people who shifted the spiritual climate over nations, not with the power of prayer. Prayer with understanding can change things. Yes, it can. Elijah was a man of like passion, the Bible says, yet he prayed. Say in the name of Jesus. One more time, in the name of Jesus, I obtain grace to pray. If you came here and your prayer life has gone down, or perhaps until now you have believed that anyone who is serious in the prayer life must be someone who is getting into ministry, please give yourself a renewed orientation. Prayer is an instrument for end time survival. You cannot escape the arrows that fly by day, the noisome pestilences, the destruction that wastes in noonday. Pray for me is wonderful, but you must learn to fan the embers, the flames on your own altar. Hear me, young people. I hate to be a bearer of bad news, but let me make an honest admission. The days today are very different from the days of our parents. The level of honesty has changed. The level of sincerity has changed. You will have to use the weapon of prayer to create your own reality. Otherwise, get set to join a long queue that may never move. Are we together? Yes, sir. Pray, oh. Gentlemen, pray. 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 Apostle, but I don't have a job yet. Good news. Pray. Use that time to pray while you are waiting. The Bible says, watch and pray. There is a devil who has vowed that you will not rise. He says, say unto God, how terrible art thou in thy work, Psalm 66 and verse 3. Through the greatness of thy power shall thy enemies submit themselves to you. You want to tame life? You must master the art of prayer. Mommy, don't watch your children become armed robbers and hooligans and say it's just the times, it's their days. Don't let them send you to the grave. No. You may not have the strength to fight them because they are now bigger than you, but you can bring them to their knees through prayer. Father, my womb will not give birth to an armed robber. No, my womb will not give birth to a prostitute. I cannot give birth to a child that will be the reason for me to die early. Hallelujah. When ministry is not working, man of God, pray. Don't complain. There is no reward for complaining. Pray. Pray. Someone looks at you in the place of work and just says, I hate you. You are supposed to be the next director, but I hate you. You are not my tribe. You are not this. Arguing there will only be, you will be recording calamity upon calamity. Leave them in peace. Go back to the central control room of the universe and begin to pray certain things. Do you believe what you're hearing? Then in addition to prayer, you must be sound in scripture. Now let me submit to you, haven't encouraged you to pray. Prayer in ignorance is just wasting your energy. What gives power to prayer is the word compliancy. of your prayer. This, we have a generation of prayerful people, but most people pray amiss. What gives power to your prayer is its word compliancy. Beyond the sound of your voice, beyond your sweating and rolling from left to right, if there is no word compliancy to your prayer, you simply dissipated energy in futility.